1/35th scale diorama of the SAS in Oman 1973.
Making the diorama. Terrain in Yemen and Oman. Model kits and accessories used. Building the diorama base. Foam cut and shaped. Checking the depth of the culvert and position of vehicle. Foam covered, rocks fixed and culvert being built. One rock at a time. Final touches on the cacti. Checking height of the acacia trees. The Indian house crow. His eyes are made from bondic, a liquid plastic. Sign made from plastic card, balsa, PE nuts and homemade decals. Soda cans made from milliput and homemade decals. All soda labels are from the 1970s. All rocks painted, signs and grass on, rubbish added and sand being shaped. The last corner waiting for sand. Smoke grenades made from milliput, PE bits, screw and homemade decals. Acacia trees planted, and leaf litter scattered. All scratch built less the PE buckles and packet of lucky strikes. Adding the dust from the pulverized rocks. Building the pink Panther Land Rover. The chassis being placed in position. Flat tires being made and battle damage to the steering. Paint chips and rust added to the chassis. And also added to the tray. And also the front of the Rover. The right side mounted rifle scabbard has been damaged. Making realistic looking instruments using bondic over decals. Dry run to see how the pink Panther looks on the diorama. Adding the combat load. Field pack straps not attached yet. Field pack straps are now on. The Land Rover is ready for its final weathering. Spotlight globe made with copper wire and bondic. Globe in position. Canvas cover for the L7 general purpose machine gun, made from coffee filter paper and PE buckles. Nyrax folder and China graph pencil made from plastic card, copper wire and homemade decals. Final weathering complete. The pink Panther is ready to be mounted onto the diorama. And now, the diorama in a historical setting.
The situation so far. At At 11:34 hours on the 7th of April 1973, an SAS patrol was approaching Al-Mazuna. The Sultan of Oman's armed forces had cleared the route 24 hours earlier. A previously unknown rebel group, loyal to the Popular Front for the Liberation of the Occupied Arab Gulf, attempted to ambush the patrol at the culvert where the vehicles are channeled. The rebels waited until the second vehicle, call sign 32 Bravo, was on the culvert before detonating the Teller mines. The mines were used by Germany in the Second World War. The rebel group's intent was to have an explosion at either side of the culvert as the center vehicle crossed. However, their lack of knowledge regarding explosives became evident when their ambush attempt partially worked. The first issue was that they failed to take into account the reinforced concrete slab that formed the road over the culvert. The slab deflected most of the explosive and shrapnel away from the driver. The slab was laid and the culvert built, courtesy of the Royal Engineers. In the 1960s, squadrons from the 131st Parachute Engineer Regiment conducted support operations around this area. The second issue was not to have a main line laid between the two points of detonation. This resulted in the first explosion cutting the wire, and as a result, the other mines failed to detonate, saving the patrol commander from serious injury. As the mines detonated, the rebels opened fire upon 32 Bravo, at a range of approximately 300 meters. It has been speculated that the rebels had assumed that they would ambush a patrol from the Sultan of Oman's armed forces, seeing that an SOAF patrol had passed the ambush location 24 hours previously. The last thing the rebels expected was to open fire upon an SAS patrol who was heading towards Al-Mazuna to conduct humanitarian assistance to the local population. The SAS patrol's counter-ambush drill was aggressive, instinctive and well-rehearsed, which quickly regained the initiative back from the rebels. This was achieved by 32 Bravo's immediate response, which saw the trooper remove the canvas cover from the L7 and return fire at the rapid rate. 32 Bravo engaged both rebel locations with suppressing fire, thus enabling call signs 32 Charlie and Alpha to move to higher ground, form all-round protection, and support the stricken vehicle by fire. It didn't take 32 Bravo long to use four liners of ammunition. Once the other call signs joined the firefight, he switched to the normal rate, only firing at rebels that exposed themselves. During the whole engagement, barrel changes were conducted after firing 200 rounds. Barrel changes were carried out in order to prevent the barrel overheating and causing unnecessary stoppages on the machine gun. As the ambush was initiated, the patrol medic, who was traveling in 32 Alpha, realized that there would be casualties in 32 Bravo. He quickly got organized and moved by foot to the ambushed vehicle whilst taking harassing fire from the rebels. The main casualty from 32 Bravo was the corporal driver. The fragmenting culvert caused injuries on the right side of his body, the most serious being a compound fracture of the lower leg. Meanwhile, the rebels were receiving sustained, accurate fire from three directions, making their position untenable. 32 Charlie confirmed that two rebels had been wounded and that they were preparing to withdraw to the east. Whilst the battle continued, at 32 Bravo's location, the wounded driver was still in his seat, unable to move and exposed to the rebels' fire. The trooper manning the machine gun relocated himself to a position that enabled him to provide covering fire for the personnel left at the vehicle. The trooper threw smoke grenades to provide a screen as the medic and commander extracted the driver into dead ground. As the casualty was being moved from the vehicle, there was a moderate amount of bleeding from his wounds. The removal of the driver became more complicated as they were approaching cover. The movement caused the compound fracture of the lower leg to rupture the tibial artery, causing a priority 1 casualty evacuation. As the casualty's condition deteriorated, the rebels commenced their withdrawal under fire. Call signs 32 Alpha and Charlie maintained contact, which gave the patrol commander space to coordinate the battle and casualty evacuation. The patrol commander moved to the Land Rover, folded down the back of his seat and set up his command post. At the same time, he ordered the trooper back to assist the medic in the treatment and stabilization of the driver. The commander established communications with higher headquarters in order to coordinate the pursuit of the withdrawing rebels. Once the rebels had withdrawn out of small arms range, the patrol commander reinforced his position by redeploying call signs 32 Alpha and Charlie to form all-round defense on the stricken vehicle. They were then tasked to prepare a landing zone to the west for the medical evacuation helicopter. Liaison occurred at the higher headquarters, and the Sultan of Oman's armed forces had a mounted infantry company on patrol, close to the contact area. They were ordered to follow up and destroy the rebels. As the rebels began withdrawing, the medic, assisted by the trooper, commenced treatment of the casualty. Whilst direct pressure was applied to the wound, the medic administered morphine, then using the trauma scissors, cut off his boot and trouser leg. Once that was achieved, he then set about clamping the ruptured artery. Concurrently, the trooper inserted an IV line into the casualty's left arm and attached a bag containing 1 liter of saline. Within moments of the saline being administered, the driver had a seizure from the effects of blood loss and shock. As a result, the IV line and bag were torn out and the shell dressing around the fracture was ripped off. During the seizure, the casualty vomited, which further concerned the medic, for he saw traces of blood, which suggested that the driver may have internal injuries. The medic, assisted by the trooper from 32 Bravo, worked quickly to stabilize the casualty once more. The patrol commander called for an aeromedical evac. As the helicopter was inbound to their location, the commander organized for a stretcher to be prepared, and then he moved with the casualty to the landing zone. The remainder of call sign 32 maintained all-round protection. Call sign 32 Bravo's Land Rover was inoperable in its current state, and will have to be recovered. Initial damage assessment is that the vehicle has got a broken steering assembly. The blast has pulled the side-mounted rifle scabbard apart. The indicator light cover has popped out. The pickaxe handle was blown off, and cartwheeled over the Rover. And ended up on the culvert. The wire catcher was snapped in two by a rock. The top half ended up on the bonnet. The spotlight lens was shattered, with glass on the dashboard. The side mirror has been broken. The shards of mirror are scattered along the culvert. The water jerry was split along its seams from the impact of rocks. The coal sun compass knocked over. Both tires on the driver's side punctured by rock fragments. Oil leaking from the cracked engine sump, and the rock that did the damage. Also, water splash and trail from the split water jerry. And finally, the driver's webbing was dislodged from the vehicle with the initial explosion. Which leads us to this point in time. All personnel are either at the landing zone, or providing all-round protection. Call sign 32 Bravo's vehicle immobilized at the culvert, and sign everywhere that a contact had taken place. Special thanks to World Music for providing the soundtrack, epic Arabian battle music, The Arrivals, The Great Fortress and The Golden Age, and epic Middle Eastern war music, Escape from the Hell.